Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Going Low, How Profane Politics Challenges American Democracy, by Finbarr Curtis, narrated by Adam Barr. Introduction. On January 8, 2021, Twitter suspended the account of Donald J. Trump. Anyone checking the president's tweets found instead an explanation that sounded like it was crafted by a newly sentient robot. Twitter suspends accounts which violate Twitter rules. This was no small blow to what had been dubbed the Twitter presidency. Twitter provided a direct channel for the president to rally his supporters and insult his critics. Trump's detractors had long called for suspending the account, but Twitter was hesitant to interfere with its users' free speech. Trump finally crossed the line when his words incited a violent invasion of the Capitol. Twitter's tipping point was not the offensive content of the president's speech, but the violent actions it inspired. This distinction between words and actions is a familiar feature of discussions of free speech, but it is unclear whether speech on social media is free. Twitter rules are not laws. They are corporate guidelines that claim to protect the public interest. The Twitter ban raised questions about who could regulate public speech in a democratic polity. As a private corporation, Twitter is not bound by First Amendment protections. Citizens have a right to speak, but they do not have a right to be heard on social media. This raises further questions about democratic discourse in an age when so much political speech is funneled through corporations with virtual monopolies over their respective media. What rules govern speech, and who decides when these rules should be enforced? Disputes over speech and offense are the focus of this book. Discussions of free speech in the United States often focus on legal debates about the First Amendment. Going Low addresses the law in part, but most of the attention is paid to arguments about rules and norms that govern civil discourse. These arguments are especially visible when liberal democratic institutions are under duress. Illiberal politics has adopted an offensive style that has tested the limits of liberal ideals of free speech. To understand these limits, Going Low brings together two overlapping themes: the rise of illiberalism and debates about offensive speech. Offense is about more than hurt feelings. Giving offense can be a way of exerting dominance over others. It turns speech into contests over winning and losing. One way of winning is by profaning what other people hold sacred, especially when doing so intentionally and without regret. In Trump's case, his repeated refusals to apologize for giving offense show that he has triumphed over liberal norms of civility. The profane and offensive style of Trumpism effectively articulates the grievances of illiberalism. One counterintuitive argument that this book proposes is that contemporary illiberalism is not anti-secular. Rather, Trumpism's profane politics fits with secular distinctions between religion and the state. It is a profane politics that makes no public theological or moral arguments. This is a counterintuitive way of thinking about secularism, as the word secular is often taken to mean non-religious. In this book, secularism describes institutions rather than persons. Secular liberals can be personally religious, but they insist that these convictions are private matters. I suggest that illiberal politics also classifies religion as private, but it seeks to expand the scope of privacy and shrink the public. Rather than resist religious privatization, illiberal secularism valorizes the private sphere in a process of super-privatization. Illiberal secularism protects markets from government regulation, reduces scientific authority to mere belief, and maximizes the sphere of religious freedom. It limits the scope of liberal democratic institutions in favor of a state defined primarily by the military and police. The privatization of everything dovetails with attempts to destroy public civility and profane liberal pieties. Illiberalism's opponents are divided about what this offensive style means for free speech. Some hope to restore liberal civility. In her 2016 address to the Democratic Convention, for example, Michelle Obama exhorted the crowd not to stoop to the Republican nominee's level. As she reminded her audience, "When they go low, we go high." The best way to respond to politicians who went low was with a dignified refusal to engage. Rather than trade insults, Democrats were encouraged to keep the faith that civil discourse and a commitment to telling the truth would win out in the end. Critics from the left, however, have argued that civility is a pointless response to people who do not seek to be civil or included. These critics assert that illiberalism needs to be canceled. Debates about civility and illiberal offenses, then, reflect different evaluations of the threat that going low poses to American democracy. So much winning. The Twitter ban added insult to the injury of the lost election. Twitter's decision to suspend Trump came at a moment when he was losing his grip on power. Losing was never the plan. In a 2016 campaign speech in Albany, New York, Trump prophesied, "We are going to win so much. We're going to win at every level. We're going to win with the economy. We're going to win with military. We're going to win with health care and for our veterans. We're going to win with every single facet. We're going to win so much you may get tired of winning and say, 'Please, please, Mr. President, it's too much winning. We can't take it anymore.'" The spectacle of winning was a gleeful performance of semantic excess. Trump's presidency promised so much winning it could not be contained within the basic rules of grammar and propriety. Winning exuded a transgressive energy. It will be so much. It will be too much. Americans wanted to win, but winning might be more than some people can take. The people who could not take it were the losers. According to Trump, losers were parasites within a culture of success. As he explained, "There are people, I categorize them as life's losers, who get their sense of accomplishment and achievement from trying to stop others." Trump's losers were not necessarily those with fewer economic resources, although they sometimes were. Losing was about social status. Losers were weak and disrespected. They were driven by envy and resentment. The leisure of winning and losing kept score in a social world in which people cared a lot about what other people thought of them. In Trump's America, losers tried to constrain successful men by making them follow rules. Losers abounded in zoning boards that would not let Trump build, journalists who refused to acknowledge his accomplishments, and above all, the guardians of civility who insisted time and again that Trump had gone too far. Trump was out of line when he gave offense. When he crossed uncrossable social lines by insulting some group or person with language ruled out of bounds within liberal public discourse. Perpetually vexing liberals, Trump had mastered the art of owning the libs. The Twitter ban hit so close to home because it promised to make him the sort of loser who was forced to follow someone else's rules. It was a triumph for liberals, who Trump took such pleasure in offending. Winning and losing are familiar aspects of social life. However, Trump's brash reduction of politics to a no-holds-barred contest between friend and enemy seemed extraordinary, surprising, and inexplicable to journalists and academic theorists. Going low suggests that an analysis informed by the history of religions is well positioned to explain the appeal of transgressive rule-breaking in politics. For one thing, religion is about rules. Under secular governance, religious rules are not explicitly penalized by law, but rely instead on social norms followed by self-disciplining people who are governed by a sense of shame. A shameless person who gives offense without regard for social censure can exercise a potent form of charisma. A charismatic rule-breaker exercises an unrestrained libidinal will that defies social taboos. Taboos define what lines cannot be crossed, what subjects cannot be discussed, and what behaviors cannot be tolerated. Someone who willfully violates taboos commits acts of profanation that are simultaneously dangerous and exciting. The stakes for taboo violation can be especially high when not everyone agrees on the rules. Someone who laments profane behavior in one context can welcome deliberate acts of profanation that offend someone else. Arguments about offensive speech are contests to determine who gets to make rules, and the stakes for these contests are especially high when it is unclear who exercises rulemaking authority. Profanations. Scholarship on religion and American politics often focuses on the political activity of groups conventionally classified as religious. In part, this book addresses religious subjects by considering defenses of Christian civilization, Islamophobia in American politics, evangelical identity formation, and responses to religious diversity. My goal, however, is to use ideas from the interdisciplinary study of religion to account for what makes things profane. I am interested in sentiments, ideas, and identities that do not belong in liberal discourse. Rather than a study of public debates, this is a study of public fights. Each chapter explores a public controversy to understand how feelings of honor, pride, dignity, envy, and shame affect how people argue with each other. The emphasis is on what happens when people trade insults and on how the visceral attachment to winning for the sake of winning has shaped American religion and politics. The study of religion helps to understand offense in several ways. First, the feelings at stake in offensive speech are private sentiments that, like religion, are often excluded from secular public discourse. Shame, in particular, poses problems for secular divisions between public and private spheres. People are expected to feel ashamed when their actions violate norms and break rules. The criteria for public shame are unclear, however, when there is no agreement upon the norms and rules because these are dependent upon diverse religious commitments that are classified as private. Shameless behavior, then, can be taken to be a symptom of the loss of religion's power to shape public norms that govern private behavior. One potential response to this loss would be to recover a sense of public religious decency. But another response is the deliberate and unapologetic performance of shameless behavior to dramatize the moral impoverishment of secular institutions. Going low suggests that the shameless and profane character of Trumpism is part of illiberalism's appeal. Trump's staunchest supporters did not vote for him despite his offensive behavior, but because of it. Going low is a defiant rejection of secular liberal attempts to replace Christian criteria for shame with norms and rules appropriate for a multi-religious society. Second, religious offenses play a prominent role in current debates about identity politics. Like religious politics, identity politics complicates secular liberal models of public discourse. As a critique of unmarked liberal individualism, identity politics was imagined as an emancipatory project that hoped to resist overlapping forms of collective oppression. As Kianga Yamata Taylor explains, "But identity politics was not just about who you were. It was also about what you could do to confront the oppression you were facing." Or, as black women had argued within the broader feminist movement, the personal is political. For some liberal commentators in the age of Trump, however, identity politics was a symptom of tribalism run amok. Some argued that leftist identity politics produced politically correct policing that bore responsibility for alienating white Trump voters. Like religions, identities are labels assigned to curious mixtures of sincere, intimate, and personal feelings that feel private, but also mark membership in groups. This is not to say that identities are essentially religious, because nothing is essentially religious. It is to say that the analysis of religion can help to inform the analysis of identity politics. By saying that nothing is essentially religious, I am following Jonathan Z. Smith's assertion. While there is a staggering amount of data, of phenomena, of human expressions and experiences that might be characterized in one culture or another, by one criterion or another, as religious, there is no data for religion. Religion is solely the creation of the scholar's study. It is created for the scholar's analytic purposes by his imaginative acts of comparison and generalization. This is the starting point for my scholarship. The idea that religion is an invention of comparison and generalization is a product of what I believe is Smith's theory of language. In my reading, Smith was informed by a pragmatist tradition that teaches that words are not things in the world. They are concepts that help make the world intelligible. Words organize and communicate information about the world within the conventions of language. There might be non-linguistic things, but there are no non-linguistic words. Rocks might exist outside of language, but they do not call themselves rocks. People do use the word religion, but religions are not people. In this sense, religion is not a self-identified term. Lumping together diverse sets of ideas, practices, and institutions as religious makes sense only when people make observations and comparisons. This is not to say that religion cannot be defined, but that it can be defined in multiple ways and for different purposes. There is no such thing as a wrong definition of religion because there is no stable referent for religion that exists in the world. Rather than limiting or constraining knowledge, this malleability allows for creative and inventive interpretations of the stuff called religion. One revision I would make to Smith's statement, however, is that I substitute the word people for scholars. Everyone observes and compares. To speak of religion is to enter a contested discursive field. The legacy of these discursive contests means that the label religion comes with historical and cultural baggage. This baggage is particularly prominent in secular divisions between religion and politics. A distinction between religious rules and political rules has not existed in all societies in all times and places. The relatively arbitrary nature of these divisions makes for fraught contests over which rules govern everyone and which rules are private concerns that arise from voluntary commitments in a multi-religious society. Secular divisions can appear to marginalize the stuff called religion by restricting its public influence. But secular privacy can also help to invest the private sphere with an aura of sacrality in need of protection. The need to protect the sacred points to a third reason for the relevance of the study of religion, which is that speech can register as offensive when it crosses contested boundaries between sacred and profane. By sacred, I do not mean some persistent, timeless human essence. Sacred stuff does not need to be deep and heavy. It is, rather, a familiar part of social life in which some things are classified as set apart and therefore command reverence and respect. As the sociologist Emile Durkheim explains, sacred things are not simply those personal beings that are called gods or spirits. A rock, a tree, a spring, a pebble, a piece of wood, a house, in a word, anything, can be sacred. While identifying something as sacred might be arbitrary, the consequences of such classifications are significant. Following the rules for how to treat sacred things demonstrates respect for social authority. Deliberately breaking those rules challenges authority. Practices of producing, protecting, and profaning the sacred participate in drawing and redrawing rules. Things marked as sacred are treated differently from ordinary things. Deliberate acts of profanation, in contrast, return the sacred to ordinary political life. As philosopher Giorgio Agamben explains, if to consecrate, sacare, was the term that indicated the removal of things from the sphere of human law, to profane meant, conversely, to return them to the free use of men. While sacred things should not be touched, the profane world is accessible. Treating the sacred as ordinary can be a mode of political critique. In Marxist theory, capitalism profaned all that was holy by assigning everything a cash value. As the Communist Manifesto declares, "The bourgeoisie has stripped of its halo every occupation hitherto honored and looked up to with reverent awe. It has converted the physician, the lawyer, the priest, the poet, the man of science into its paid wage laborers." In Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels' formulation, halos are not distinctive to priests. Physicians, lawyers, poets, and scientists could be stripped of their halos when they are treated as wage laborers whose professions commanded no special reverence. Going Low investigates speech that strips halos from a variety of social phenomena. Lost halos also play a role in the Marxist contention that profanation reveals truth, as in the proclamation, "All that is solid melts into air. All that is holy is profaned, and man is at last compelled to face with sober senses his real conditions of life and his relations with his kind." Actors from across the political spectrum feel that there is something about profanation that reveals the real conditions of life. For this reason, profane speech can be upsetting to some while appearing to others to be especially honest, true, and real. This equation between giving offense and telling the truth is especially prominent in the illiberal logic of owning the libs. By refusing to constrain his speech according to liberal norms, Trump seems to his supporters to be refreshingly honest. Whatever the intentions behind acts of profanation, keeping something sacred requires protection. When protections fail, this can animate passions ranging from excitement to anxiety to anger. These sentiments are prominent in the stuff labeled religion. Early uses of religio involved a range of feelings invoked by breaking rules that marked the sacred as off-limits. These sentiments included inhibition, scruple, fear, and the object that invoked those emotions: taboo, bond, obligation, oath, treaty, transgression, guilt of transgression, curse, etc. These emotions can be aroused through deliberate acts of desecration or simply by treating sacred things as if they were ordinary. To be clear, not all rule-breaking is profanation. Profanation, for the purposes of this book, is a transgression that refuses to repair social damage through acts of contrition. It breaks rules without shame. Profanation poses a more formidable threat to the social order than sin does. A sinner might break a rule but can still demonstrate respect for the institutions that uphold rules by performing the proper rituals of penance. A perpetrator who apologizes or is punished is still bound by rules. An act of profanation that is allowed to stand precipitates a crisis of authority. In Trump's case, his repeated refusals to apologize after violating liberal taboos demonstrates that norms of civility are powerless to stop him. Trump's demonstration of liberalism's fragility fits with historian of religion Bruce Lincoln's observation that failure to prevent profanation marks a loss of social power. In a study of the exhumed and displayed bodies of priests and nuns during the Spanish Civil War, Lincoln argues that deliberate acts of desecration have a potent political message. In the Spanish case, demonstrating the ordinary humanity of supposedly sacred bodies challenged the authority of the Catholic Church. As he explains, profanation can demonstrate dramatically and in public the powerlessness of the image and thereby inflict a double disgrace on its champions, first by exposing the bankruptcy of their vaunted symbols and second, their impotence in the face of attack. In Lincoln's analysis, profaning dead bodies was a leftist challenge to organized religion. Profanation, however, is politically neutral and has been used to advance communism, fascism, conservatism, liberalism, and anarchism. What political uses have in common is that unrepentant profanation produces winners and losers. Liberalism. Going Low is not primarily a study of Trump himself. This book takes the rise of Trumpism as a starting point for 7 case studies set in a moment in which the norms of liberal civility were under duress. This state of duress led secular liberals to proclaim, "This is not normal." The norms of secular liberalism expect politics to serve public goods and aspire to principles of fairness. Liberals do not know what to do when citizens unapologetically seek to gain power at the expense of vulnerable others. The inability to come to terms with winning and losing arises from an internal tension within liberal views of private interests and public goods. Liberal theories of the state begin with self-interested actors who enter into social contracts to protect their property. These same people should then engage in disinterested discussions of public goods with a diverse population of strangers. For citizens fighting to preserve religious, racial, and sexual hierarchies, however, the ideal of disinterested discourse is a preening, naive, and weak abdication of national sovereignty by globalist elites. In a world in which you are either a winner or a loser, you exploit the vulnerable or you become vulnerable yourself. For this reason, the people most energized by calls to make America great again were those who felt threatened by what they saw as eroding social power and national prestige. Trump's claim that losers are envious was ironic, or perhaps especially appropriate, as Trumpism oozed populist envy and resentment. As Pankaj Mishra remarks in his study of resurgent populist movements, "Seized by a competitive fever and taunted by the possibility that they are set up to lose, even the relatively affluent become prone to inventing enemies, socialists, liberals, a dark-skinned alien in the White House, Muslims, and then blaming them for their own inner torments." This is not to say that Trump supporters were objectively losing in a material sense. Trump drew a great deal of support from rural and suburban areas that were relatively safe, prosperous, and homogeneous. What mattered was the perception that other people's gains were your losses. If you convinced yourself that your way of life was threatened, then liberal civility demanded dangerous concessions to the very groups who were gaining power at your expense. As a repudiation of dispassionate technocratic liberalism, Trumpism's populist aesthetic promised vitality by unapologetically embracing winning. Trump's unbridled sincerity and offensiveness promised to defeat the specter of political correctness. For Trump supporters, political correctness was an insincere restriction of the ability of white Americans to be honest. It offered apologies and shame in place of strength. The antidote to this coercive regime was common sense, a realistic appraisal of the threats posed by racial, ethnic, sexual, and religious others. As political scientist Nadia Marzuki explains, populist leaders owe their success to an ability to present themselves as the voice of common sense. This makes them all the more effective when it comes to disparaging the discourse of the enemy, be it trusts, the federal government, international socialism, the United Nations, and so on, as naive, overly idealistic, and irresponsible. Furthermore, compliance with liberal civility eroded the religious freedom of Christians. A corporation was forced to cover contraception for its employees, despite its moral objections. A baker was forced to bake a cake for a same-sex wedding. A child was forced to learn about Islam. All of this was felt as a loss of a once Christian nation. Liberal models of free speech and religious freedom make it difficult to reckon with the power of offense. Rather than address the political potency of profanation, liberalism classifies religious convictions as interior. For this reason, religious offenses should do no real harm. In his Notes on the State of Virginia, for example, Thomas Jefferson proclaims, "The legitimate powers of government extend to such acts only as are injurious to others. It does me no injury for my neighbor to say there are 20 gods or no god. It neither picks my pocket nor breaks my leg." This classic defense of liberal toleration ties freedom of speech to freedom of religion. As matters of mind and spirit, neither speech nor religion cause injury because neither affects the property nor bodies of others. There are no winners or losers. Jefferson's assertions were at odds with a Christian history that saw great injury in offenses against God. Laws forbidding blasphemy or compelling Sabbath observance protected a Christian society from infidelity and moral anarchy. Modern liberal ideals of freedom asserted that these threats were overblown. Thinkers like John Locke argued that not only were laws that compelled religious participation unnecessary, they undermined Christian sincerity by forcing people to become hypocrites. It was pointless to compel people to be religious because religion was an interior matter beyond the scope of civil institutions. Similarly, free speech allowed people to say what they wanted without fear of external coercion or reprisal from others. The line between the interior and exterior, however, is not always so clear. At times, religion is a private zone to believe whatever one wants. At other times, religion endorses social norms that govern individual behavior. Speech should express sincere internal commitments, but it is also a vehicle for democratic participation in which citizens engage other members of the public. Postcolonial critics of secularism have drawn attention to internal tensions in liberal ideals of free speech and religion. Questioning the apparently apolitical quality of religious offenses, Saba Mahmoud argues that secular liberal dismissals of the injury caused by speech reflect an impoverished understanding of images, icons, and signs. Going Low extends these critiques to develop an economy of offensive signs. In this case, the economy of offensive speech governs an unequal playing field in which some people's gains are other people's losses. Winning and losing are core features of capitalist economics, and speech under capitalism can help to produce, challenge, or fortify inequalities. Politically contested speech would not be so controversial if it simply let people express themselves. As literary critic Stanley Fish asserts, few people believe in free speech for the sake of freedom itself. Free speech arguments are never made in the name of the abstraction itself, but in the name of some agenda to which free speech rhetoric has been successfully attached. And when the argument is won, the victor will not be free speech, but that agenda. To get ahead in a speech economy, you must compete for resources with others who are left behind. The question then is, who wins and who loses by classifying some speech as free? Talking about liberalism can be a daunting task because there is no unified or consistent liberalism. Rather than simplify this complexity by stipulating a precise technical definition, this book tries to make sense of contemporary usages of liberalism. To this end, I stay as close as possible to describing liberals as invoked by the snarling, two-syllable pronunciation of the word often heard in the American South. Contemporary liberalism is the product of a tradition that begins with the defense of rights found in people like Locke and Jefferson, but over time is reckoned with more complex relationships between freedom and equality. As social movements such as organized labor and civil rights transformed liberalism, freedom changed. Movements like these recognized that social forces other than the state could constrain personal freedom, and liberal reformers sought to use democratic institutions to advance public goods. Protecting rights without ensuring the ability to exercise rights drew criticism for creating negative peace. Criticism of negative peace also shaped the liberal principles of inclusion that are the focal points of the controversies in this book. To be liberal is to take seriously the difficult and often inconsistent demands that inclusion makes. Indeed, a liberal is someone who spends a lot of time taking things seriously. Aspirations toward diversity, equity, and inclusion require attention to changing sensibilities about what language and imagery is offensive. According to religious studies scholar Donovan Schaefer, these changing sensibilities ask for self-criticism on the part of people who benefit from different forms of inequality. Bodies that once felt like unchallenged masters of their space, white bodies, male bodies, cis bodies, straight bodies, rich bodies, citizen bodies, are being confronted more and more with a demand to respond to the violence in the wake of the comforts and pleasures they enjoy. Schaefer argues that these confrontations become more frequent in the increasingly mediated world that amounts to an increasingly saturated shame panopticon. It is unclear, however, what shame contributes to liberal ends. Ashamed white liberals can be more preoccupied with assuaging their own feelings than with seeking practical solutions to institutional inequality. White conservatives reject the premise that they have anything about which to be ashamed, and they see liberalism as a weak system that calls for their self-loathing. Tying offense to inequality raises sociological questions about what bodies are unchallenged masters of their space. Liberals are divided about whether offensive speech should be assessed by the subjective intentions of the speakers or by objective sociological and historical conditions. In the latter case, offense causes harm because it discursively reinforces social inequalities. There is an economy of speech, then, that mirrors economy in the financial sense of the word. Arguments about what is offensive often rest on evaluations of unequal distributions of wealth or unequal protection under the law. Many who defend free speech absolutism are those who personally benefit from viewing speech as mere words. In this way, leftist challenges to unrestrained free speech come from both within and without the liberal tradition. Illiberalism. The changing rules governing offense frustrates Americans who identify as conservative. They are tired of hearing that they should be ashamed. They want someone to fight back, to rescue them from what Schaefer calls a state of shame exhaustion, in which it becomes easier to repudiate shame altogether than to respond to the moral demands placed on them. In some ways, conservatism is a variant of liberalism and, with its emphasis on individual rights, is closer to the classical liberalism of the 18th century. American conservatives have been more comfortable with naked assertions of self-interest. Rather than see a tension between freedom and equality, they accept that social resources will be distributed unequally and hope that they win more than they lose. According to the conservatives who voted for Trump, contemporary liberalism has made too many compromises and has been naive in the face of threats. Trumpism is the response to the fear that someone, somewhere, is threatening to take something that is rightfully yours. As a vigorous response to threats, Trump's illiberalism makes his supporters feel safe. Where things get tricky is that conservatism prides itself on respecting norms and the rule of law. This raises the question of whether Trumpism is conservative, or whether it marks a turn toward fascism or ethno-nationalist populism. Liberalism does not know how to reckon with illiberal movements labeled populist. As a self-proclaimed billionaire from New York, Trump would have been the enemy of 19th century populists. Populism in the 21st century, however, has come to describe any movement where the people fight back against perceived elites. Populist movements can be found on the left or right, but are rarely in the middle. Populism echoes liberal critiques of the unequal distribution of power and resources. While liberalism sees the problem of inequality as a matter of contractual fairness among parties with different interests, populists argue that the people should have what is rightfully theirs. This depends on who speaks for the people. Populists claim to speak for the people, but the people are not simply the collection of citizens who happen to live in a particular place. Rather, appeals to the people invoke organic forms of identification and solidarity. For this reason, populism and what has become labeled identity politics go hand in hand. Unresolved anxieties about identity politics are often at the crux of what liberalism deems offensive. While direct insults toward individuals are hardly welcome, they do not have the taboo quality of bigoted language that insults members of groups. Liberals are more likely than conservatives to see social privileges as unearned advantages that contribute to unfair distributions of power. Offensive speech reinforces these privileges and exacerbates inequality in a way that goes beyond personal feelings. Rejecting liberal sociology, conservative rhetoric claims to treat everyone as individuals responsible for their own lot. Conservatism in practice, however, seeks to shore up families, churches, nations, and markets as regulating institutions that keep individuals in check. Right-wing populism is especially vexing to liberalism when, unlike conservative individualism, it explicitly affirms identifications based on bloodline, heritage, or civilization. What makes Trump so honest is that he told the truth that some people are born better than others and should have nothing for which to apologize. Aspects of this attitude have always been present within American politics. Trump's departure from more recent conservative rhetoric, however, is that he came out and said it in an age when liberals thought they had made progress. By going low rather than high, he revealed a profane truth about inequality at the heart of white Christian identity politics. Like members of any social movement, Trump supporters are not a monolithic group. Many voters said they disliked Trump, but voted for him because they disliked the alternative even more. The millions of people who voted for both Trump and Obama were not so obviously motivated by resentment of an African-American president. Not all of the arguments of this book apply to all Trump voters. The arguments do, however, wrestle with how liberalism stokes Trumpian resentment. Going low suggests that, rather than any internally coherent political philosophy, Trumpism is illiberalism as an end in itself. Trump promised to turn liberals into losers. This means that the movement has no identity apart from liberalism. It requires liberalism to exist. While Trumpism is illiberal, it is not anti-secular. Indeed, Trumpism is more secular than secular liberalism. What makes this possible is that secularism has no fixed content. For the purposes of this book, secularism refers to processes of religious privatization that separate religion and state.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.